Welcome to the best commander podcast in the world. Today, we're doing an archetype deep dive.
We're going to look at the Superfriends archetype, find out what makes it tick.
I'm your host, Joe Cherries.
I'm your host, BZ, and that makes us the Nitpicking Nerds. You can find this particular episode on Spotify, Google Play, and iTunes. And it's arguably one of the best things to listen to while you're swimming at work. I think it is. And you can go to Patreon and support us further.
Actually, scientifically proven to be the best swimming at work podcast.
What could be better?
Yeah, exactly. So, what is an archetype deep dive?
Well, we certainly have an answer to that question.
And that answer is?
Well, just right now off the top of my head, without cutting it all, I would say we define the archetype, talk about how to play it, and talk about some commanders, some staples, and then just all the ins and outs of the archetype. So if you have no idea what Superfriends is, you're going to come into this video going, huh? And you're going to leave going, ah.
You're going to say, huh, both times. All right, so what is a Superfriends deck, BZ?
Well, a Superfriends deck is a type of deck that aims to leverage planeswalkers as a primary source of card advantage and use their ultimate abilities to close out games.
So the Superfriends is a term that comes from, well, the Superfriends, which is a superhero group that fights together to defeat evil. In this case, we're taking planeswalkers and we're putting them in the superhero slots, and we're going to use those planeswalkers to win the game here.
But we're not fighting evil, we're fighting our best friends.
And they're evil.
They're evil in this case.
Next, we're getting into how to play Superfriends. So we actually asked like five different questions, important questions that you're going to have when you're building a Superfriends deck and when you sit down to play it. So the first one is, what's the correct number of planeswalkers to play?
Wow, that's a great question. I'm so glad you asked it. The correct number of planeswalkers varies depending on what you're trying to do or your power level. But for us, 12 to 20. 20 is like pretty high and 12 is on the low side. But maybe like 15 to 17 is like your exact sweet spot. This is not like a tribal deck where you need 35 to function. We're trying to almost combo off. We're going to get planeswalkers, put loyalty counters on them, and then ultimate them. You don't need to ultimate six planeswalkers to win a game. You're good with like one or two.
Yes, and you have to be careful because you don't want to just throw in planeswalkers because they're planeswalkers. There are a lot of bad planeswalkers and a lot of trap planeswalkers. We're going to talk about that later, but you want to take the good ones and you want to really focus your deck around those good ones.
Oh, and if you weren't familiar with this, at least on this channel, planeswalker, that is the worst card type in the format because you can't attack an enchantment. You can't destroy an artifact with two tutus turning sideways. The fact that planeswalkers can be attacked means you can't just amass like a board of eight of them super easily. You can't just play one and then play one and then play one. You got to protect them, and there's only a few that can protect themselves well enough or replace themselves well enough, and you're just not going to find 28 planeswalkers to go in a deck.
Yeah, exactly. And the point here is you're probably thinking, BZ, planeswalkers are really, really good in 1v1. Why would they not be good in EDH? Well, you have three opponents as opposed to one. That means three opportunities / turns for people to attack it rather than just one.
But my next question right now then is, what makes a planeswalker playable?
Well, there's three key things that it needs at least one of these. One, replacing itself. Most planeswalkers do this very well and very easily. If it has like draw card as its plus, things like that, getting your card back, getting your card's worth from a planeswalker. The next is protecting itself, putting out bodies to protect it, destroying the biggest threats on the field. Things like that are ways of protecting itself. And the last one is a game-ending ultimate. Sometimes a planeswalker isn't very good, but the fact is its ultimate is so good that if you get there, you will just win the game. Some planeswalkers actually do all of this.
I'm going to add something. I'm going to add replacing itself mana-wise. A five-mana planeswalker that draws a card is real bad because would you pay five mana to draw a card? Or let's say it makes it to your next turn. Would you pay five mana to draw two cards?
Absolutely. No. Yeah, that is an absolutely great point. Exactly. You want to get the mana's worth. Something like, it's much different. Like, you get to see it in a card like Narset, where it's like, you get the card back, and you get more value after that. It's like, you're not just getting, it's like, again, three mana impulse, bad. Not a good card. But you add in the fact that there's more value to be had with this guy, you get a good card.
Yes. We're going to get to specifics later. So yes. We're not going to read anything right now. When should you deploy a Planeswalker? Now that we know that what makes them playable and how many we should play, when do we actually play the ones we have?
Well, the best time is always going to be on an empty board. It's not even close. If there's no creatures to come after your Planeswalker, you're going to be able to plus that Planeswalker probably at least 2-3 turns in a row, unless it gets spot removed.
Yeah, and then there's the... It's also harder to spot remove Planeswalkers. We're never, ever going to advocate for Hero's Downfall or anything like that. So they're going to have to catch it with, like, Beast Within, one of those catch-all answers. I think one of the common play patterns is, like, okay, empty board, Planeswalker, maybe another Planeswalker, plus them. Then next turn comes around, people have got some tools, and they're like, I'm coming for you. And you're like, I know. And then you just wipe the board again, and you just plus, and you start it all over.
Yeah, exactly. I agree with that. That happens a lot. Next, if it can survive. If you put a Planeswalker down, and you look at the board, and you say, hey, it's not going to die here, that's going to feel a lot better than throwing it down and saying, well, there's 20 power of attackers on the board. It's dead. Be very careful. Maybe it can come down, answer the threat that can kill it. Maybe it comes down, puts a blocker out for the threat that can kill it. Those are things that make the situation a lot better.
So if you have Planeswalker and there's a giant threat that's going to kill you or result in an eventual loss for you, it's okay to just play a Planeswalker and kill the threat knowing the Planeswalker will die. It's better than losing. That's still a time you should play one.
Yeah, exactly. Killing key threats or big threats is a huge reason to play a Planeswalker. You have if it has a minus, or maybe it has a static ability that can prevent maybe somebody from going off. That's also another reason. Maybe the threat is your opponent.
Yeah, and that's even another thing that makes Planeswalkers worse than other types is you can only activate their abilities on sorcery, so you're losing all of the extra value of like holding up an instant that we talk about all the time. All right. How much should you give up for a Planeswalker when deck building? We've got a lot of choices. Take a normal deck, and if you want to add 20 Planeswalkers in it, you have to cut a lot of things.
Yeah, exactly. This is a really tough question to answer, and you need to approach it depending on power level, really. It's tough. You sit down, you look at your deck, and it's like, let's say you're at a power level where maybe Heroes Downfall is playable. Do you want to put in an Obnixilus over your Hero's Downfall? It gets really weird and interesting.
Yeah, that's because he's way worse than a Hero's Downfall, and Hero's Downfall is not good.
Yeah, exactly. There's interesting questions to be answered, but I think you need to approach it and be very careful with it, because you don't want to just be taking out all these instants and all of these very strong spells for Planeswalkers that might not do nearly as much.
Maybe something people don't do that they could do that'd be helpful is take, if you have 100 cards in your deck, look at the next best card you could play. It's probably pretty good because your Planeswalker deck is probably not one color. So you take that and you look at the worst Planeswalker and you're like, is my deck just better if I switch these?
Yes, and it will affect the game plan. At what point, if you're going below like maybe like 10, maybe if you're hitting like the 9 and 8 Planeswalkers, it's like, well, maybe you're not even a Superfriends deck anymore. That's different. So maybe you want to try and keep the number up where we said like 12. So you really are actually a Planeswalker. If you're playing like, it feels like if you're playing like 8, it's like, well, you're just a deck with a lot of Planeswalkers.
It almost feels more like a combo deck where you're like, all right, I have 4 cards that combo with Doubling Season, and I'm going to get you.
Yeah, exactly.
It's less of a Planeswalker loyalty style. All right, lastly, we talked about it. How do you protect Planeswalkers?
Well, we have spot removal, instants, stuff like Beast Withins. You got your Swords of Polishers, any sort of removal to take a creature off the board. Often you get to leverage these by going, hey, I'll just sit back, wait for the attacker to come at my Planeswalker, and then instant speed remove it.
Yeah, and if somebody has a good creature, and they you have a bunch of mana up, and they attack your Teferi, and they know, like they probably know you have something, because why would you just let it die? So they might not even attack it, knowing that they want to keep their cool creature, and then that just means you get to keep the removal spell.
I'm attacking it. You can't stop me.
Well, yeah. So if you have like something you really don't want to die, then maybe you won't.
Yeah, no, I'm me. You know, I'm going for it.
You're gonna go for it with Yuriko with the combat damage to players.
Yeah,
trigger.
That's like the one. Yeah, that's a good point. I'm not doing it with that. Next, board wipes. These are key in decks like this. They're so important. The fact is, you play a creature wipe, it leaves all your threats aren't creatures. Your threats are all Planeswalkers. So you play a board wipe, everything's gone. Nothing can attack your Planeswalkers. Now they're demanding spot removal or hasty creatures. Both things, which are not super abundant in EDH.
Well, if you just make tokens with your board wipe, then plus. So if you get tokens, this haste creature doesn't really matter.
That's true.
Lastly, this is rare, but politics. If you say, don't attack my Planeswalker, I'll give you this, there is some benefit. I think most people are going to be a little keen on it. Like, well, I don't want to lose next turn. So you might not get too many deals, but maybe you could lower the stakes a little. Like, hey, if I minus this planeswalker, will you let it live? Because you know it won't ultimate next turn.
Yeah. Like, I think people will do that. Or saying the deck faded thing. I'll plus on you.
Yeah, I'll just give you a faithless living. I don't know what's in it for you at that
point. What's in it for you is that they say they won't kill your deck faded for the next couple turns. Maybe you'll get an extra plus out of it. Or a minus.
I think what you can actually do with politics is say, I'm going to answer this threat. Like, if you let me plus the stack Faden, I'll steal his Aetherflux Reservoir so we don't lose the game. What are they going to do, say no? say no to that?
No, they're not.
Yeah, exactly. All right, next the next little category. Commanders to play with Super Friends, and then what kind of colors do you end up in? So we'll start with, like, some of the most common Super Friends commanders.
I mean, Atraxa. Everyone knows this is one of the most popular commanders of all time and one of the most popular ways to build it. Well, it simply is Super Friends. White, blue, black, green for a 4-4 flying, vigilance, death touch, lifelink. I knew it the whole time and BZ definitely didn't whisper it right there. And at the beginning of your end step, proliferate. So the reason that this is so good, simply you proliferate your planeswalker counters. You put this down, you put an extra counter on all of your planeswalkers.
And she bolsters your life. You're going to kind of be at a virtual million life. That's what happens with planeswalker decks. All your planeswalkers get attacked, so you get attacked way less. Mm-hmm. So she just has lifelink, just gaining you four a turn. She blocks really well. Anything that's a 3-3 or less really just can't attack into it.
Yeah, and things that are bigger than it don't want to attack into it because she just trades off, and you don't really care that much about her. She provides a good amount of incremental value, but trading her off does not feel bad.
No. All right, next, Sisse Weatherlight Captain and Captain Sisse. Not going to read these. They both just tutor for planeswalkers. They can put them either into play or in your hand, and then you play them. Sisse is white-green, and then the other one is five colors.
Yeah, five colors is the – that one's much more popular. Captain Sisse is – if you're going to go, if you're willing to go down on colors and you're not worried about it, that one's way stronger. But five color Sisse, Weatherlight Captain, very popular.
I really enjoy that Captain Sisse was not a Super Friends commander and then all of a sudden became a Super Friends commander like 75% of the way through that card's existence.
Yes.
Because they eroded planeswalkers to be legendary.
Yeah, I didn't even think about that. Next, we have Golos Tireless Pilgrim, 5 mana for a 3/5. When he enters the battlefield, search your library for a land, put it into the battlefield, tap, pay 2 in Wooburg, exile the top 3 cards of your library. You may play them without paying the mana cost until end of turn. He comes down, he ramps you, and then his activation is going to let you play potentially 2-3 planeswalkers in one turn.
This card has nothing to do with planeswalkers. It's a 5-color good stuff commander that'll help fix you / ramp you. I don't really like that this card exists. I think it's a little dumb. Maybe I'm just being a negative Nancy or a nitpicking nerd, if you will. I just feel like it was one of the extra 5-color commanders we don't need.
Yeah, he's boring.
Planeswalkers go right in that deck. Nicol Bolas the Ravager is another one because he flips into a planeswalker. Again, he has no synergy at all with planeswalkers, but if you want to play Grixis Bolases or Grixis bad guys, you can have him as your commander.
Yep, Nevin Rawl, brand new commander legends, a brand new threat.
From a brand new set.
Yep, which is actually Larry Nevin. When he dies, he destroys all artifacts, enchantments, and creatures. That's why you want him. He doesn't destroy planeswalkers.
Nope, the disc could not destroy planeswalkers because they did not exist back then, and Nevin Rawl wants to be an exact replica of his disc. Be pretty stupid if he wasn't. So they nailed it with the design, and it means, cool, we get to play all the Esper Walkers and blow everything up every turn.
Yep, exactly. Killing creatures. And the last one, Nivens are Reborn. Not much synergy with planeswalkers. Though there are a lot of 2-color planeswalkers, but you play him because he's 5 colors.
That's about it. And any the colors, anything. You can play any, literally any combination of colors for Super Friends, which is not true for every archetype. You could play mono green. You could play blue black. You could play Naya. Just, there's too many planeswalkers now. So the colors you are definitely kind of informs your decisions about, all right, how many planeswalkers am I going to play? What do I have to give up? Because if you're mono green, you're playing most of the Garrick's, most of the Nisses. Your standards are lower. The more colors you have, the higher your standards should be.
I think most of the time you're going to be aiming for 3 colors because you really want to like get your planeswalkers. You want your planeswalkers to be as strong as possible. When you start going lower on planeswalkers, they start getting real weak real quick.
Yeah, the monocolor ones are not great.
So we went over reasons to play planeswalkers, but We're going to go over the best ultimates, which means the planeswalkers are playing because we want that ultimate. And we're going to go over the best tech walkers, where we want their pluses, we want their minuses, and that's what's important about them.
Yeah, these guys, we're just going to read the ultimates. It's kind of what we're here for. So first one, Liliana, Dreadhorde General. She starts at 6. Her ultimate is a -9. Each opponent chooses a permanent they control of each permanent type and sacrifices the rest. Well, this is the best ultimate in the game. The game is over. There is
not,
no game.
Not only is this one of the best ultimates in the game, this is one of the best planeswalkers in the game. This card's incredibly good. Every single line of text is relevant on it. Her pluses are weakest, but she's still just incredible.
Yeah, she comes with a built-in barter and blood, too. That card's great. How about Nicobolas, Dragon God?
Nicobolas, Dragon God comes in with 4 loyalty, and he -8s each opponent who doesn't control a legendary creature or planeswalker loses the game.
The only hoop you have to jump through is you got to make sure they don't have a legendary creature.
That's not very hard.
Well, it is Commander, where they have access to a legendary creature every single game.
That is true, yeah, but I'm willing to use my spot removal spell at that point on it.
Well, how about a board wipe?
Or a board wipe. Either way, hopefully they don't have their planeswalkers. We can't answer those. We have no answers.
We do. Well, here's one. Ugin the Spirit Dragon. He starts at 7 and he ultimates at 10. The ultimate is draw 7 cards, gain 7 life, and put 7 permanents from your hand onto the battlefield. Usually that is 5 more planeswalkers, 2 more planeswalkers, a bunch of ways to proliferate, and then you just ultimate those planeswalkers. Then you win.
Ugin is completely and utterly bonkers. He controls the board with his plus and his minus. This card is very strong overall.
Tamio, Field Researcher, her ultimate is pretty simple. She starts at 4 and has -7, draw 3 cards. You get an emblem with Omniscience. You can cast spells from your hand for free.
That's pretty simple. I mean, it's tough to lose when you can cast everything for 0 mana.
Mostly draw spells chain into each other, and then you're just going to, all right, draw 3, draw 5, draw 2, win.
Yeah, exactly. Next, Nissa Vital Force. She comes in with 5 loyalty, ult at 6 loyalty, which is only 1 above it. And whenever you play a land, you draw a card. This isn't game winning like the other ones. But she ults 1 turn after coming out every single time, and it's a great draw engine.
I will correct you a little, because it's whenever a land enters, you draw a card.
Yes.
Fetch lands are 2.
Yes, that is true. Yes, absolutely super stellar. Then one of the most pushed ultimates of all time, Chandra, Torch of Defiance, enters at 4 loyalty, ult at 7. Whenever you cast a spell, deal 5 damage to any target.
We were looking at this one, and we were going, what are the best ultimates? And I'm like, yeah, this one's really good. It's won us both multiple games. And then we're looking at comparable ultimates. Like, there's a Narset that's, her emblem is, whenever you cast a non-creature spell, deal 2 damage to any target. Like, oh my god, what is Chandra doing? She's just dealing 5 damage with every spell. It's like so pushed.
Yeah, so much more pushed and so much better than the other one. Teferi, Hero of Dominaria, enters at 5, ultimates at 8. You get an emblem with, whenever you draw a card, exile target permanent.
Good luck losing when that's your emblem. Every threat is gone. There are no threats for you. You have an instant speedy way to draw 2 cards. I can't imagine you lose that game.
I love that divination becomes like draw 2, exile 2 permanents.
Oh, you're the monarch? Well, this isn't gonna go well for you. It's just like that is one of the better ones for sure. And then here's one. It's the best commander card of 2020, if you haven't heard. Teferi, Master of Time. He starts at 3 and he ultimates at 10. But if you know this card, you can ultimate in literally less than 2 turns because of his instant speed thing. And it says take 2 extra turns after this one. You don't lose when you take 2 extra turns. That's how this goes.
Yeah, this card is completely insane. Teferi, Master of Time, one of the best planeswalkers in Commander. Not even close.
Yes, it's like top 3 or something.
Absolutely insane. Ajani, Steadfast, comes in at 4, ultimates at 7. You get an emblem with, if a source would deal damage to you or a planeswalker you control, prevent all but 1 of that damage.
Oh, you get hit by a 10-10, 1 damage. You get hit by a 21-21 Commander, 1 damage. This is way better in lesser powers where you're not just going to get infinite combos, because this doesn't stop infinite combos, but if you're in a creature meta or a light on combos meta, this is like very close to game over.
I do love the idea of like they load the Aether Flux Cannon, they shoot this giant cannon at you, boop, 1 damage.
Dink.
Just, yeah, bounces off your chest.
But I like that in some cases they could still just do it infinite times. It doesn't matter.
They keep shooting you with the laser that's doing nothing, basically.
And then eventually you die.
Eventually you die from it, though.
They're like, why did it take so much? Why did it work?
And the last one, Nicobolas, God Pharaoh. Starts at 7, ultimates at 12. Exile each non-land permanent your opponents control. This one isn't super game-winning, but if you know this card at all, its plus is incredible. It's 2 pluses. are incredibly strong. Its minus is incredibly strong. Every single activation of this is like game breaking.
Yes, I would almost argue that Nicol Bolas's ult is his plus one. Each opponent exiles two cards from their hand. If you fire that off twice, you just got 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12 cards, and your Planeswalker's not dead. And he starts at 7. Even if he gets knocked down, the problem with this one for me when playing against it is you can knock it down, but you have to kill it or it's going to destroy you with his plus one.
Yeah, his plus one is incredibly strong. And then once his plus one isn't relevant, he just starts casting spells off your opponent's deck. God, that card is good.
It's so nasty. It's definitely worth the 7 mana. It's one of the better ultimates. All right, this is the Tech Walkers. They're here to fill out slots. We can replace some spells with these if they're removal or recursion, and they're going to help make our proliferate game a little bit better. First one, Dak Faden, the greatest thief in the multiverse and the deadest thief. He is 1 blue-red, starts at 3, plus 1, draw 2, discard 2. Well, target player, but you're going to target yourself. Minus 2, steal an artifact, and then his ultimate is so bad that I'm not going to read it.
Yeah, you're never going to ultimate this guy. He really, really doesn't want to ultimate. His ultimate is minus 2, steal an artifact.
It's permanent. You just steal someone's Soul Ring, steal someone's Signet. They're down something. You're up something. This is one of the best ones as well.
Yes. Oko, Thief of Crowns. Everyone's heard about this a million times. I'm actually not going to read. I'm going to put it on screen. You make things in the Elks. I mean, this card is incredibly good. It pluses to 6 right away for 3-mana Planeswalker. What was going on?
Why? Why are they doing this to us? Narset, Part of Veils, is kind of a combo piece. We said she impulses for her minus 2, and their static is opponents can't draw more than one card. Everyone's trying to do that. So this is going to be, they have to kill this or they're in trouble.
Yeah, exactly. The Windfall's also just a win with this. That's what's great about Narset. You throw a Windfall with Narset, all of a sudden, you've just won the game.
Like, congratulations. Ashiok, Dream Render, stops searching and minus ones to mill someone for 4. Then each opponent exiles their graveyard. So it's a little bit of graveyard hate in your Planeswalker slot. Although it doesn't really do anything else. You know, if you proliferate this up to 10 counters. Yeah.
This one is very strong in higher power level EDH.
Yes, the searching is big.
Yes, where the searching is big and hating out those graveyards is big also.
Yes, absolutely. All right, Garrick Wildspeaker, he untaps 2 lands and then he makes a beast. Or you want to play pattern with this one is plus 1, untap 2 lands. Then next turn, minus 4, overrun for a decent attack if you're going the tokens route. Or you can just keep untapping 2 lands every turn. If you got lands that make more than 1 mana, it's going to be great.
Yeah, exactly. If you're playing a Nykthos type deck, card's pretty strong. Teferi, the Time Raveler, 1 blue-white, enters with 4 loyalty. Plus 1, you may cast sorceries as though they had flash until your next turn. Minus 3, return target artifact, enchantment, or creature to its owner's hand, draw a card. And he has a static ability that says your opponents can only play cards at times that they could play sorceries.
Man, that draw card tacked on there is just such a punch in the face. This card is nasty.
I don't know why. Yeah, it's just you get to bounce something, draw a card. This card always replaces itself on the very, very worst case scenarios. And on the best case scenarios, it's bouncing like a 9 drop and then staying alive and preventing people from going off or stopping you from comboing.
If it didn't draw a card, it would still be right here in this Tech Planeswalkers category. That's just so much gravy. There's the gravy boat. Imagine us taking it and pouring gravy all over our opponent's battlefields. If you're comboing off, they can't stop you. We can move on to Saheeli, Sublime Artificer. When you cast a non-creature spell, you get a servo. Hey, Planeswalkers are non-creature spells. This one actually works with Planeswalkers.
Yes, this one's great in Planeswalker decks because you play this one out, then you start playing all your other Planeswalkers, you get Chump Blocker, Chump Blocker, Chump Blocker all day.
And if you find one of your creatures that can help get counters on Planeswalkers, you can make more of them.
Yeah, that's true. You don't really do that too often with Saheeli. You really just care that she's an enchantment that can be attacked.
Yeah, she rarely activates.
Next, you have Tamio, Collector of Tales. 2 green-blue, enters with 5 loyalty, has a stack ability. Spells and abilities your opponents control can't cause you to discard or sacrifice permanents. Plus 1, choose a non-land card name. Then reveal the top 4 cards of your library. Put all with the chosen name from among them into your hand and the rest into your graveyard. Minus 3, return target card from your graveyard to your hand.
This is interesting because it's self-mill or recursion. This is kind of like, all right, you got an E-Witness in your deck. Easiest swap of your career.
Yes, you're in a Planeswalker deck. You just get the E-Witness out, put in the Tamio. Tamio is also very strong. It can have random like upside of like, you can't discard. Maybe they're, I don't know. They just all awaken the Urns while they cast. Gotcha.
Well, you're immune to that Narset BS combo we just talked about. Hey, you want a Windfall? Well, you can't. I'll just not discard and draw one.
That's true.
It's kind of funny. It turns it into a cantrip instead of you lose the game.
Yeah, well, that's funny. I never even thought about that. I never thought how windfalls don't work when you have this Tamiya. Yeah, that's cute. And a Ren and Six. This is just a bonkers planeswalker. Red in the green. Enters at 3 loyalty. He pluses to return a land from your graveyard to your hand. He minus ones to deal 1 damage to any target. And he ultimates to say that instants and sorceries in your graveyard have a retrace.
Which means you can cast them from your graveyard by discarding a land and paying their mana cost.
Yes. So he's just a really good planeswalker. I mean, if you're playing lots of fetch lands, this card is very strong. If you care about landfall,
it's draw card. This with Nissa, you can kind of see there's like groups of these that go together. This one and Nissa, Vital Force really go together. Also, if you get the ultimate off, you just board wipe every turn of the game. You're like, all right, Wrath of God.
He's also 2 mana.
Wrath of God. Kill your Sarah Ascendant before it gets up to the big 6/6 area.
Also kills utility creatures.
Kill your mana elf.
Yeah. I've done that plenty of times. Just be like, okay, that thing's annoying.
Boop. I think that was in Modern.
I've done that plenty of times in Modern and in
Noble Hierarch. Noble Hierarch.
I would do it in EDH. I do it in Modern.
Both the bird. Moving right along, next category. These are staples of the archetype. These are not planeswalkers, but they're going to ramp up our strategy. These, arguably, most of these are the reason to play the strategy in the first place.
I mean, the first one is Doubling Season. You know it. You love it. It's a 5 mana enchantment, and your planeswalkers enter with double counters, and that's pretty much all it says.
Yes. Doubling Season is out. Play almost any planeswalker, especially any of the ones we just mentioned about ultimates, and you're going to win. It's a 2-card combo. There's not a ton of ways to get them both out at the same time, so you kind of want to hold Doubling Season. You don't want to just, all right, guys, I played it on turn 3. Go ahead.
Card very similar to that. Deep Glow Skate. It's a 5-mana creature. It enters, and you can double counters on any number of permanents you control. You choose all your planeswalkers. You get them off to 70 million loyalty, and you ultimate them.
Yeah, this one I like this card more than Doubling Season. The order makes a lot more sense. I like that you can play your planeswalkers first. All you gotta do is protect them from one turn, plus them, and then take them from 5 to 10 or 6 to 12, and then ultimate them.
They're both good. I mean, they both are just really, really good in your planeswalker decks.
I just like Deep Glow Skate. I think it's better.
I think it's a better
design. I'll say it.
I think it's a better design. I don't think it's necessarily better.
Okay, next, Oath of Teferi. It flickers a non-land permanent, which is almost nothing, but it's 5 mana also. And it says, your planeswalkers can activate an additional time.
But another thing, it's not just nothing. It can just, you can go like, put your planeswalker onto one, flicker it, so it comes back with all of its loyalty.
Yeah, the only awkward thing is it comes in a turn.
That is true.
So you don't really get the activation of it. Still a good card. It literally says, planeswalkers can do this. All of the oaths say, you get a bonus for planeswalkers, but there's only like 2 or 3 good ones.
There's one you really want to play, and it's this one. Next, we have a couple proliferate cards. We have Flux Channeler. Whenever you cast a non-creature spell, you proliferate. Evolution Stage, whenever land enters the battlefield under your control, proliferate. And Carriage Bastion, which is a land that taps for colorless, but you can pay 4 and tap it and proliferate.
Yes, Carriage Bastion, only because it's a land slot, makes it a good way to proliferate. Because when you have nothing better to do, you can still add a counter to your planeswalkers in an emergency. I've used that one to decent effect. And then in Flux Channel and Evolution Stage are crazy.
Yeah. I mean, Flux Channel triggers off your planeswalkers. Super awesome. And Evolution Stage just lands. If you're playing fetch lands, this card is insane.
There's a common pattern is play planeswalker, plus it. You know, it survives. Next turn, Evolution Stage, fetch land, ultimate my planeswalker.
That's fair. Yeah, that's a fair way to play Magic.
Can definitely happen, and you're going to destroy your opponents.
Next, we have Arena Rector and Academy Rector. They're both 4 mana, but when they die, you can get an enchantment into play or a planeswalker. Well, we love planeswalkers for a planeswalker deck, and Doubling Season's almost always a key in these decks.
Oh, is that an enchantment?
Oh, and that's an enchantment.
Oh, okay. I was wondering what that was.
Oh, man. And maybe if you're... sometimes you're just, you don't have that many planeswalkers on the field. Doubling Season won't be that good. You can get Omniscience. Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah. In an emergency, we can get Omniscience, which is functionally a planeswalker ultimate anyway. It certainly feels like one. All right. Next, this is kind of like hard mode. How do you want to get your planeswalkers up on loyalty? Just take all the turns. Time walks. If you want to have 15 planeswalkers and 15 time walks in your deck, you could do that. Get 2 out to start time walking. And the thing is, your planeswalkers are going to draw you cards, help you find more time walks. So this is kind of like a parasitic, not fun way to do it, but I'm not telling you how to play. If you want to time walk and proliferate that way, the game's still going to be over in the same fashion as Doubling Season Tamiyo.
I know. My planeswalkers only activate once per turn. Well, what if I just had more turns?
Yeah, I guess I better get more turns then. Chain Veil says same thing as Oath of Teferi. You can activate planeswalkers another time if you tap it.
But if you don't activate a planeswalker in your turn, you take, what,
two life.
Oh, no.
The downside is very heavy. They thought about that very carefully.
Yeah. Call the Gatewatch and Ignite the Beacon are tutors. Call the Gatewatch gets one planeswalker and puts it into your hand, and Ignite the Beacon gets two planeswalkers and puts them in your hand.
I'm really not sure which one of these is better. We're not going to mention, like, Demonic Tutor. Obviously, Demonic Tutor finds a planeswalker. These are planeswalker-specific. I don't know if Call the Gatewatch is better or Ignite is. Ignite is an instant, and it gets two, but it's five mana. And then Call is a sorcery, but it only gets one, but it's three mana.
I really think I like Ignite more because I love the instant speed. I love not having to have everyone have the information before the go-around.
Here's my Ugin.
Yeah, like you get to go at the end of the last guy's turn. Okay, I'm going to go get my Ugin and my other whatever else now.
Yes. Now, one way to control boards is board wipes, but this is not that. It is Humility. Two white, all creatures lose all abilities and are 1/1s.
This card's insane. I mean, we're playing a deck that doesn't care about creatures, which, okay, Humility is a stellar card. Yes, it's expensive. We are very aware. This card is just going up and up and up. But this card is very strong. It's very hard to answer because a lot of decks that rely heavily on creatures have creature answers to it.
Yeah. Oh, I need Artifact and Enchantment answers. Well, I got Cost Caterpillar and Reclamation Sage. Not with Humility, you don't. They're going to need a Nature's Claim or something to get it.
Yeah, exactly. Next, we have Field of the Dead. We think this is just a great one. Planeswalker decks are usually three or more colors on average. So Field of the Dead, absolutely a free roll. And you get lots of just free blockers to protect your planeswalkers. And they're more relevant in planeswalker decks than the average deck.
Yeah, if I can go planeswalker fetch land or planeswalker put a land into play, now I don't have to worry about protecting it because I just get two or three zombies that come with it for no investment. I cannot hype up Field of the Dead enough. It is like my favorite land ever. It is so good. I think it's one of the best cards in Commander ever in the history of the universe.
That is so over-exaggerated, but the card is good.
This is the internet, Joe.
Oh, you're right. I didn't realize we were on the internet.
Yes.
Next, we have some board wipes. Toxic Deluge, Blasphemous Act, some of the best board wipes ever printed. They're going to help protect your planeswalkers. Another way to help protect your planeswalkers, Thematic Compass. When you have seven lands, this flips into a Maze of Ith, which is going to be awesome.
It just deters attacks, and it does have the play pattern of people know that you can do it so they don't attack, so that you can still do it. And even with everyone knowing that at the table, I've still had that happen.
Yep. Next, we have Ophiomancer, which is a 3-mana 2/2, but on every upkeep, if you don't have a snake, you get a brand new Death Touch snake.
So people just aren't... This is like Maze of Ith. They know you have a snake. Except if you use your snake, you just get another snake, and then it's like they just sacrifice their creature for no reason. This is better against one or two or three creature board states. It can get overwhelmed, sure, but then even then you take out their biggest thing.
Yeah, you take out the best creature every single time. That sounds pretty good. And this one I thought was really awesome. I didn't realize how good this was in a planeswalker deck. It's Pramacon, the Sky Rampart. Just Sky for a 1/5 wall flying defender. As it enters the battlefield, choose left or right. Each player may attack only the nearest opponent in the chosen direction, and planeswalkers controlled by that opponent. I love that it says nearest in the text.
Yes. Attacks getting you down? Well, now two of the players can't attack you. You get to choose left or right. So you can't... The guy across from you, they're never attacking you. But you get to pick who has the worst board state and then say, oh, only that person can attack me.
Yeah, maybe someone's playing more of a control-y deck and you'd be like, all right, the control deck can attack me.
Yeah, blue-white. Oh, well, who's your commander? Like, I don't know. What's the guy's name?
Tygum.
Tygum, yeah. Tygum, you're not going to get any attacks off on me.
Yeah.
You have one creature in your deck.
It's weird. It was weird to me how I've never thought that card was very good. I thought it was unique and fun. And then all of a sudden I'm like, oh, wait, no, it's just good in Planeswalker deck.
Yeah, 5-color Super Friends, that seems like a real player. This is our favorite part. This is where we get nitpicky, the traps. What are all the cards that are people, you know, they put in the Planeswalker decks and we think, hey, you'd be better off without this. This is actually hurting you.
Okay, so what we're going to do here is we're going to list them and we're going to give you a quick reason why we wouldn't play them mostly. We're not going to really linger too much because the first part here is just Planeswalkers we think are trapped.
First one, Tevish Zat, Doom of Fools. The investment is too high. The ultimate is too unimpactful. And we're not trying to sacrifice planeswalkers.
Yeah, this card is amazing in Aristocrats decks. Absolutely stellar. Probably just a great 99 card even for those decks. Always a great commander for those decks. Not so much for planeswalker decks.
Yeah, Tamio the Moon Sage. She taps something down. That's her plus. Her plus is really bad. Her minus two is finicky, and it's hard to even find a spot where it would work. It's tough to get her to that alt. The alt is good, but I think her plus and minus are so bad that I just wouldn't play it.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of this. I've seen it do a lot of work. I've seen it draw like 3-4 cards with her minus, but still not a big fan. Elspeth, Sun's Champion. Pluses to make 3-1 ones. Minuses to board wipe all the big creatures with power. I don't know. She's fine, and I think if, depending on where your power level is, you can play her. But overall, I'm not looking for her.
In our power level, I'd say she's a trap. It just looks better than it is. You don't need... her ultimate's not even that good. You just don't need any of this stuff.
I would really want... I'd rather play this in a deck where I can take advantage of the 1-1s with, like, a Skull Clamp.
Yeah, we really can't abuse the 1-1s at all. They're just fodder. Narset Transcendent. Her plus is abysmally bad. Her minus is not as useful as you'd think in a Planeswalker deck. We got enchantments and creatures and walkers and things. We're not building around Narset. And her ultimate's fine. It's good. But the rest of it is terrible.
Yeah, I think this Narset card is really, really bad. I remember when it was first hyped up and spoiled.
Ugh. So funny.
Yeah, poo-poo butter.
$60 pre-orders.
A Johnny Unyielding. I mean, I just don't think this card's very good. There's not much to talk about with it.
Skip.
Yep. Nicol Bolas, Planeswalker. This card is 8 mana, and nothing is impactful enough. I think the best way to look at this card is put it side by side. In fact, I'll do it for you with my graphics. But put it side by side with Nicol Bolas, God Pharaoh. Look at those two cards and realize you're never playing Planeswalker.
Yeah, he destroys a non-creature. Creatures are the thing that most endanger your Planeswalkers. Can't even hit it. Then if you want to hit one, you have to minus two and steal it. Might not be something you want or care about. Nicol Bolas is going to be so low, you're not going to be able to get him to this sweet ultimate. And his sweet ultimate, yeah, it's really good. But he's 8 mana.
Exactly.
He's no Ugin. Sarkhan the Masterless, the trap here is don't turn all your planeswalkers into creatures. They're going to die.
Don't turn all your planeswalkers into creatures because it's just not going to be relevant enough. That's not how we're winning games.
No.
That's not the point of this deck. We're not an attack deck. Sure, you can have one cool turn where you go, whoo, 20 in the air with all of my planeswalkers. Sure, that's really, really cool. But it's not good.
How did you get 5 planeswalkers? How did you amass 5?
I don't know. I'm saying once in a while you get that really cool turn.
All right, this next one, any Vraska, they're all not good enough. They're too expensive. They're all designed for standard. And I would argue that the Unseen it wasn't even really that good in standard.
It was fine. It's all a little bit of
it fun. Actually was okay.
Ugh. Yeah, that black-green deck.
That deck was cool.
It was actually mono...
Mono black splash.
Splash green, yeah.
For Abrupt Decay and Vraska. Yep. Why are we talking about this? Dovenban! Just draws cards.
This card's butts. This card is total butts. I don't even think it's close to playable, and it's in a ton of lists.
Yeah, the appealing thing is I can draw 2 cards and gain 4 life. For 4 mana, would you play that card? I wouldn't.
I certainly would not, and its plus stinks. It just makes one creature.
Bubbles something, or it shrinks it by minus 3.
Not good. Next, Jason Reveler Secrets. I mean, he's a bad draw engine. He's a bad bounce engine. He's a bad ultimate.
This is your classic standard card. Yeah, all right. Draws a card, but for 5 mana, EDH, we just can't. We just have to have higher standards than that. Same is true for a Johnny the Greathearted. He helps your planeswalkers out, but he doesn't do anything else.
Yeah.
He's like a bad sorcery. You can just get one of those evolution sages to do it for you.
I mean, the plus is gaining life. That's awful. Giving creatures vigilance... We don't care about attacking.
We don't have creatures.
For anyone who's not watching the podcast, I don't know what that was.
He's flailing around.
Ugh.
Anyone, most people are not watching the podcast.
Yeah, I know, but I'm broken. Liliana Vess, she can Vampiric Tutor, 5-mana Vampiric Tutor. Not very good. She pluses to make players discard.
No, target player discards 1 card.
The card's just not good enough. I'm not a big fan of it.
It used to be good, but now it's not. Narset of the Ancient Way, we just talked about how embarrassing that is compared to Chandra. And if you look at her plus, it's terrible. It like gains you life. And her minus is you have to discard a card to deal damage. Chandra just deals damage.
Yeah, see, minus draw a card, discard a card. Nope.
Actually, you know what I just thought of? Her plus one is make 1 mana. Chandra's plus one is make 2 mana. Every single portion of the card is better. How bizarre is that?
She's more mana intensive.
What is it? Why?
Yeah, she's so much worse than that, John.
That's such a weird thing we're discovering.
Cure the Crashing Wave. It's a 4-mana one. It basically is a double explore. It's just not for Planeswalker decks. That's all.
Yeah, if you got a landfall sub theme, maybe it goes with the Nissa Vital Forces and Renin Sixes. This is more of a fringe one. I wouldn't play it in every deck. Jace, the Mind Sculptor, I wouldn't play it in any deck. He brainstorms. Bouncing a creature and Fate Stealing are just complete whiffs. His ultimate's great. You're going to take somebody out. But how are you going to get there?
Yeah, the problem is he enters at 3 loyalty.
It's just not doable.
Yeah, that's the problem with this Planeswalker. It's not like when you doubling season, he comes in with 6 loyalty.
You're just never going to get there. And he's not good as a value engine.
He ults at 12.
Yes. In case that wasn't clear, you're just not getting there. Fuel for the Cause. I talked about this in some other video, but I hate it. I hate this counterspell. It's not worth the little proliferate to hold up in the counterspells video. 4-mana counterspell is not efficient. The proliferate does not make this card good.
And just to throw all these and lump these into a group, these are all bad, bad, bad cards that just happen to say proliferate. Steady Progress, Contingency Plan, Tezzeret's Gambit, Volt Charge, none of these are playable. I don't even think they're remotely close to playable, and they don't provide enough advantage for me to even consider them.
I used to play Tezzeret's Gambit, but not anymore. It's just, I got off of it. I didn't work well enough for me. Divination is not a commander card.
It's funny. It's one of those cards that you mentioned to me, because you're like, hey, you should try this because you're playing your Nicol Bolas deck. I played it, and I'm just like, got to the point, I'm like, I don't like this card. You're like, but you haven't tried enough. I'm like, I have. I don't like it.
And now here we are. It's in the traps list.
Yes.
Oath of Gideon, Peer, Imaginative Rascal. They are going to kind of have your Planeswalkers enter with an additional loyalty. But they're 3-mana investments, and they really don't do anything else. And we don't have 30 Planeswalkers. We don't have that luxury of having 30 that are good enough or that can replace spells, so these don't do enough.
Yep. Salai, Voice of the Plenty. No.
Hexproof. There's no targeted Planeswalker thing happening, and you can just protect them and ultimate them next turn. Give your opponents a window. You have counter magic, too.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
If you're in blue.
Thrumming Bird and Grateful Apparition are both 1/1 flyers that when they deal combat damage to a player, proliferate. Stinkers. These cards are stinkers. They don't fit in the game plan.
They don't work late game. They don't work early game because you don't have Planeswalkers. They only proliferate once. They have to tap. They have to connect. You can't expend resources to ensure they connect because you're a Planeswalker deck.
Next, deploy the Gatewatch. 6-mana, look at the top 7 cards of your library. You can get 2 Planeswalkers, put them in play. Problem with this is I'm not good with the math on this. If you can do the math, the number of Planeswalkers you really have to be playing to guarantee hitting 2 is way too high.
Yeah, it's too high. Maybe eventually this could be, like, there's nothing wrong with this card, but there's something wrong with the Planeswalker type that we can't play 35, like we keep saying. So this doesn't work.
And the very last little thingy here is we have the Elder Spell. This card's bad. It's bad, 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 bad. It only kills Planeswalkers. You can't rely on your opponents to have Planeswalkers. Maybe there's definitely metas where I could see this being playable. Straight up avoid it usually.
Yeah, or you're going to have it as a sacrifice 2 Planeswalkers, ultimate a 3rd Planeswalker. But how many Planeswalkers do you have? How much mana does that cost you? It's like a 3-for-1.
And you have to target your Planeswalkers. It has to fully resolve, then you ultimate it. If you target 2 of your Planeswalkers and then they go kill the 3rd one because they know what you're doing, now you just 3-for-0'd yourself.
You just lost.
Like, come on. No. No, thank you.
That's insurmountable to get back. But those are the traps. Hopefully you've learned something about Superfriends decks, or we've, you know, rekindled something in you. Maybe you want to build one. You can go to the TCG player link we have in the description for you. Buy some cards off of it. We get a kickback on the order.
Buy lots of Planeswalkers. Special shout-outs to all of our patrons. We love you all as much as we can without making you uncomfortable. You guys are super awesome, and you are the poopy babies.
Yeah, we're getting a lot of you guys. It's going to be great. The Discord is a bop. It is a party in there. There's like 900 people in there.
It's a bop. I like that. Okay, so instead of a tidbit, a patron yesterday in the Discord had a great story about opening packs. And this is not only the luckiest I've ever heard someone getting, but by far
the
luckiest.
I don't condone this purchasing pattern. I don't think it was a good idea, but it certainly paid off for them.
Yes. Okay. So they bought a box to start. Okay.
Yes.
Cool. Oh yeah. People buy box all the time.
A box of
Commander Legends. Within that box of Commander Legends, they opened a Jeweled Lotus. Pretty lucky. They took the Jeweled Lotus. They traded it to the store for 2 collector boosters. within those two collector boosters, he opened enough value to get two regular boosters. Ooh, he's going down. He's almost done here. This story is almost over. In those, he opened a foil jeweled Lotus. This is the second jeweled Lotus he's already opened, mind you. This is completely bonkers.
So, of course, now we got a foil jeweled Lotus. Trade it in for more packs.
Trades in for four collector booster packs. Within those packs, he doesn't get anything in the first two, but inside the very last pack, foil extended art, jeweled Lotus. You've got to be kidding me.
Yes. So start with a jeweled Lotus, trade it in, and you just end up getting, you just end up opening a box of Magic cards, keeping them, and then you just get $400.
Yes, he literally hit the lottery when it came to, I would believe that the odds of doing what he did are lottery-esque.
Like one in millions.
Yes, one in absolute millions. Completely insane, but that was a cool story they wanted to share. That's Propeller, our patron Propeller.
Propeller?
Propeller.
I didn't think that was his name.
Oh, it's Propeller.
That's a stupid name.
He's going to hate me for saying that.
Oh, no. Well, that's it. I mean, that's all we got for you.
Peace out, Propeller and Tribe Scouts.